Harper Audio presents We Crossed a Bridge and It Trembled, Voices from Syria, by Wendy Pearlman, read by Erin Bennett, Assaf Cohen, and Susan Nezami.
Introduction. One evening in the fall of 2012, I met Rima on a breeze-filled balcony in Amman, Jordan. Rima was a television screenwriter in Syria before 2011, when she became active in the movement against the authoritarian regime of Bashar al-Assad, and then a spokesperson for the network of local committees coordinating protests throughout the country. She was arrested for a few days and went back to work, but regime intelligence agents followed her with threats of ever more frightening punishment. She fled to Jordan, where a friend introduced us. Rima spoke with a delicate voice that belied the boldness of the risks she had undertaken, but not the heavy grief she shouldered for fallen friends and a homeland whose bleeding would not end. Her commitment to what she cherished as a revolution was unshaken. Syrians defeated the regime the moment they went into the streets, she told me. We will not allow anyone to steal our dreams again. In the nearly 5 years that have passed since that conversation overlooking the hills of the Jordanian capital, I have come to know hundreds of Syrian men, women, and children. They have included housewives and rebel fighters, hair-gelled teenagers, and businessmen in well-pressed shirts, die-hard activists, and ordinary families caught in the crossfire. Most opposed Assad rule, as do the majority of Syrian refugees as of this writing. While the drivers of forced migration have evolved over time, the majority of those who fled during the first years of the conflict were escaping aerial bombardment and other mortal punishments levied by the regime against individuals and areas challenging its rule. This book focuses on that slice of the Syrian population. The people with whom I spoke do not represent all of Syria's complex religious political landscape, and in particular those who support Assad. Nevertheless, they are a population that meets with too few opportunities to represent itself. Politicians and commentators throughout the world talk about Syrians as victims to be pitied, bodies to be sheltered, radicals to be denounced, or threats to be feared and blocked. In the whirlwind of words spoken about Syrians as a global problem, it can be difficult to find chances to listen to actual Syrians as human beings. This book offers such a chance. My drive to record Syrians' voices took shape as I watched the 2011 Arab Spring unfold on my computer screen at Northwestern University, where I am a professor of political science specializing in the Middle East. Having dedicated more than 20 years to researching and living throughout the region, I was captivated by the joyous street protests, defiant chants, and inspiring shows of solidarity that shook country after country. Like other observers, I doubted that the revolutionary wave would reach Syria. Compared to other Arab authoritarian regimes that saw mass demonstrations, Syria's single-party police state was more repressive, its military more infused with the regime, and civil society more severely curtailed. Bashar al-Assad's regime enjoyed assets such as a domestically popular foreign policy, the legacy of an extensive welfare state, and generally high regard for a youthful president. Whereas countries such as Tunisia and Egypt were largely homogeneous societies that saw most of their members alienated from the government, Syria was a diverse mosaic in which many citizens from religious minority backgrounds supported the president, who himself comes from the minority Alawite sect. Nevertheless, Syrians went out on the streets. Defying threat of injury, imprisonment, or death, dozens and then hundreds and soon hundreds of thousands of Syrians dared to protest. Or, as Rima explained it to me, they dared to dream. The more closely I followed these protests, the more I craved to discover what they meant to those who risked their lives to participate in them. I wanted to understand how the budding uprising was changing them, and how they were in turn changing the course of history. Given the perilous conditions inside Syria, I searched for stories among the millions who had fled the country. In summer 2012, I traveled to Jordan, where I spent 6 weeks interviewing any displaced Syrian I could. In 2013, I returned to Jordan and also spent 2 months in Turkey, where I conducted interviews with a more diverse mix of Syrians from different backgrounds and hometowns. In 2015 and 2016, I returned to spend several more months in Turkey, 2 weeks in Lebanon, and 3 months between Germany, Sweden, and Denmark. I continued to interview Syrians wherever I found them, families newly resettled within biking distance of my home in Chicago, decades-old residents of Dubai whom I met on the sidelines of an academic visit, and so on. Each interview connected me to ever-wider circles of Syrians with an ever-broader range of experiences and brought my chronicling of the conflict into the present. Along the way, I immersed myself in refugee communities. I roomed with families for weeks, talked in cafes late into the night, and sat at the side of the injured in hospitals and rehabilitation centers. I visited dusty refugee camps, squalid informal settlements, gymnasiums turned shelters, and countless sparse apartments. I did volunteer work that ranged from teaching journalism to eighth graders on the Turkish-Syrian border to distributing clothing in central Berlin. In these and countless other spaces, I played with children, washed dishes, scrolled through photos and videos, inhaled secondhand smoke, and joined meals as exquisite as they were tightly budgeted. And whenever possible, I asked people if I could interview them about their personal stories. The interviews that I conducted were open-ended chances for individuals to describe and reflect on life before, during, and since the start of the 2011 Syrian rebellion. Interviews ranged from 20-minute chats to extended group discussions to personal histories recorded over days and sometimes continued years later on a different continent. I conducted the majority of interviews in Arabic, a language to which I have dedicated half my life to attaining fluency. This enabled an interviewer-interviewee connection that would have been impossible had I relied on an interpreter. Indeed, it became the basis of lasting friendships, as I remain in contact with many of the individuals whose voices appear in this book. To move the project forward quickly, I recruited more than 20 assistants to help me transcribe and translate audio recordings of these interviews. Only then was I able to appreciate how the individual narratives that I gathered over years coalesced into a collective narrative that was as timeless as it was timely. I curated this book to convey the lived experience of this historical journey, exclusively in Syrians' own words. I edited testimonials for length and readability, and used pseudonyms for all speakers, unless I received permission to identify them by name. The alphabetized list following this introduction identifies all speakers with a reference to their profession, hometown, and where and when I interviewed them. An abbreviated reference to the speaker's profession and hometown is also included with each testimonial. Sometimes a story needed pages to unfold, while other times the power of a lifetime was captured in a few words. The different lengths of entries in the book capture this rich, expressive variety. The book is organized in 8 parts that trace the historical evolution of the Syrian revolutionary experience. The remainder of this introduction complements the personal stories with background on the context within which they unfolded. Some may wish to read this historical overview in full before diving into the intimate voices, or do the opposite, or move part by reading the voices and accompanying background in tandem. Any combination can achieve the goal of this volume: to explain the Syrian uprising, war, and refugee crisis, and lay bare, in human terms, what is at stake. Part 1 of this book explores Hafez al-Assad's authoritarian rule of Syria from 1970 to 2000. The history of Syria, of course, stretches millennia before that. Seat of some of the oldest continuously inhabited cities in the world, the Eastern Mediterranean, also called the Levant, came under Ottoman rule in the early 16th century. With the Ottoman Empire's defeat in World War I, the League of Nations carved these Arab areas into separate nation-states under British or French colonial control. France acquired a mandate in Syria and divided the territory along sectarian lines. Two separate states of Damascus and Aleppo contain Sunni Arab majorities and smaller Christian, Jewish, Shiite, and Ismaili religious communities, as well as distinct Turkmen, Armenian, Circassian, and Kurdish ethnic communities. The coastal Latakia region was designated a state for Alawites, adherents of a branch of Shiite Islam who historically had been persecuted. The southeastern corner of Syria became a state for the heterodox ethno-religious Druze religious minority. Following years of anti-colonial activity enlisting all communities to varying degrees, France conceded to integrate the different regions into a single republic. In 1946, Syria became a sovereign state. Syria preserved its pre-independence parliamentary system dominated by a conservative traditional elite. Already weak and unrepresentative, this system was further discredited by Syria's defeat in the 1948 Arab-Israeli War. In the decades that followed, industrialization, mechanization of agriculture, expanding access to education, and other socioeconomic developments swelled a new middle class and politicized the peasantry. Youth from rural and religious minority backgrounds, finding traditional economic and political structures unable to accommodate their growing aspirations, increasingly joined radical political parties. The Ba'ath Party, a revolutionary movement committed to Arab unity and socialism, attracted particular support. It also gained a foothold within the army, where many young men from marginalized communities had long sought an avenue of mobility. Against this backdrop of class conflict and ideological ferment, military interventions in politics overthrew seven governments between 1949 and 1963. In that year, army officers affiliated with the Ba'ath Party seized control of the state. The new regime nationalized industries and businesses, redistributed land, and extended welfare services such as education, healthcare, irrigation, and subsidies. While these reforms mobilized a mass base of support, they provoked opposition from wealthier sectors and rival political movements. Apart from those challenges, the Ba'ath were racked by their own internal divisions, which only worsened after defeat in the 1967 war resulted in Israel's occupation of Syria's Golan Heights. One of the Ba'ath leaders jostling for power was General Hafez al-Assad, Minister of Defense and Commander of the Air Force. In November 1970, he sidelined competitors and took power via a bloodless coup. President Assad replaced decades of political instability with a single-party security state. A foreboding military police establishment, including multiple security services and internal intelligence agencies, monitored, vetted, and punished both citizens and other state personnel. Assad staffed security forces with personal loyalists and disproportionately reserved leadership posts for trusted members of his own Alawite community. The Ba'ath Party, operating through thousands of cells and branch offices throughout the country, similarly acted as an instrument of local surveillance and control. It also co-opted millions with the professional and economic privileges of membership. Beyond formal institutions, Assad used alliances across society to remind citizens of the benefits of remaining in the regime's good graces and the costs of opposing it. While promoting an image of stalwart protection of religious minorities, he reached out to win the allegiance of powerful actors within the Sunni Muslim majority, including clergy. He appeased the traditionally Sunni business class by allowing them to continue and gradually expand private enterprise and trade. At the same time, he sustained a populist welfare state, including dramatically inflated employment in an enormous public sector.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.